Hey everyone, Patrick CK here. Welcome to episode 4 of 3D printing with the Monoprice Maker Select V2. Last episode, we printed a replica Cherry MX keycap and just touched the surface of support structures. There were a couple takeaways from that episode that have been incorporated in this one. Thanks to all my subscribers for the suggestions. While the Maker Select V2 is a good printer, it can be even better with a few modifications. In this episode, we're going to investigate one of the most important of these modifications, the Z-asix gantry brace. But before we make any modifications to the printer, we need to set a benchmark so that we can see if our modifications are making any difference. Of course, one of the best and most popular benchmark prints is the 3D Benchy. The 3D Benchy is designed to push any 3D printer to its limits with a wide array of challenging geometry that reveal even subtle issues related to the 3D printing process. Examining the results of the Benchy can help determine where to focus modification efforts to get a better result next time. Anyone can download the files for the 3D Benchy by visiting its official website at the3dbenchy.com and going to the download section where you can select from a number of repositories for the files. I use Thingiverse since they are already an amazing source of all things 3D CAD. A link to it will be in the description below. Simply download the zip file, extract the files, open the files folder within, and select the 3D Benchy STL model. In your favorite slicing program, confirm all your settings. I went with normal quality, 20% infill, and no support structures, of course. Save it to G-code and start printing. With these settings, it should take about 2 hours. 2 hours later, it's done. The most obvious thing you will notice is the hard line in the lower third of the boat. This was caused by a change in filament. I think it's absolutely amazing the difference in quality between the two layers. I didn't expect much, if any, change at all. The bottom third was using some generic PLA that came with the printer, while the rest of it is using Worksteel High Precision PLA, who claim to have a 0.02mm dimensional accuracy, and with the Benchy, it shows, at least compared to the generic PLA. Link to the Worksteel filament will be in the description. You see various artifacts and overall poor quality with the old PLA, but once the Worksteel filament started flowing, the quality shot up. The lip of the deck is clean and sharp. There's no stringing in the gaps of the cockpit. The only thing that really stands out can be seen at the top of the doorway and the windows, where the bridge or arches were a little trickier for the printer to make sharp. Honestly, I was amazed it was able to bridge the gap for the front window at all. I obviously have to have a little more faith in this printer. Compared to other Benchies I've seen from unmodified printers in this price range, I'm extremely happy. I'm not an expert at interpreting the results, so if you peeps see something of concern that I didn't mention, please don't hesitate to leave a comment below. Seeing the difference in the quality of the filament makes me want to go back and print my other models again just to see how different they may turn out. I might just do that later. So now we have our benchmark, and while I don't see the major issues that I've seen in other Benchies, there was still something I noticed while watching this and previous prints, and that is the obvious wobble of the vertical gantry, especially when the bed and extruder moved in quick succession. The wobble was amplified when I put a new spool of filament since there was more weight on top. This wobble will adversely affect any print, but especially ones that are tall. This is where our first and probably most important mod will come into play. The Z-asix gantry brace does pretty much what it sounds like. It will support the top gantry and keep it from moving around during printing. This is done by essentially attaching a support structure from the top of the gantry arm diagonally to the front of the base. The really cool thing is anyone can do this. It uses a few printed pieces and some hardware you can find at any local home improvement store like Home Depot, Lowe's, or Ace Hardware. There are a handful of different pieces that we will need to print, but they can all be found in one zip file on Thingiverse at the link in the description. While there are a few different configurations available, they all accomplish the same goal. I'll take you through the one I chose, which does require a few more pieces than the other configurations, but I believe offer better fine tuning in the final product. Once you've downloaded the zip file and extracted everything inside, you'll find a not small list of STL files. We are going to focus on the following 7 models. Top left, top right, bottom left for balls, bottom right for balls, back foot left, back foot right, and balls MK2. Most of these are mirror sets of each other. A quick overview of the pieces. Top left and top right will be attached to the top of the gantry frame, and will hold the rods in place at a slight angle with the help of some bolts and pairs of ball MK2 fasteners for each. We will simply call them the top mounts. Bottom left for balls and bottom right for balls will have the other end of the rod attached at the base. Each one of these will have just one ball MK2. These two pieces have large areas on the bottom that will actually go underneath the base of the printer. We will use this area to attach shock absorbing feet to further isolate the vibration coming from the printer. We will simply call them bottom front mounts. Back foot left and back foot right do not directly contribute to the brace, but they also have large areas on the bottom that will go underneath the base to attach more shock absorbing feet. We will simply call them the back mounts. Lastly, the ball MK2 is basically the bolt fastener that will help tighten down and hold the bolts in place. I chose the MK2 version because it has ridges on the outside to make adjusting them by hand easier. We will simply call these bolt fasteners, and we will require 6 of them. As the creator put it, these pieces are over-engineered, which is a good thing because you want them to last. But be wary that it is going to take some time to print all these pieces. Roughly 16 hours to be exact, and use 44 meters or 144 feet of filament at normal quality with a 20% infill, so be patient. You can print all the pieces in one go, but I thought it's better to go one at a time, although I did print 3 bolt fasteners at a time. After you're done printing all the pieces, there is very little in the way of cleaning them up. One thing you'll have to do is remove the interior support pillar of the bolt fasteners by simply bending it with a small screwdriver or pliers. It snaps right off. The only other thing I did was slightly file the screw holes on the bottom brackets with my precision round needle file. Now for the actual hardware you'll need for the configuration we are going with. You'll need 2 410mm or 16-inch lengths of 8mm or 5/16-inch threaded rods. Ace Hardware, like other home improvement stores, sell these rods in 3-foot or 910mm pieces, so you'll only have to buy one and cut it to length. I used a powered angle grinder to make quick work of the cuts. You can use a hacksaw, but for a clean edge, I'd recommend an angle grinder, or ask someone at the home improvement store to cut it for you. They usually will for free or for a nominal fee. Next up, you'll need 20 M3 by 10mm screws. Then you'll need 6 8mm or 5/16-inch nuts. And lastly, 2 8mm or 5/16-inch locking nuts. There is a pre-made hardware kit on the ultimate3dprintingstore.com website that runs for $21 and includes the bolts, screws, and threaded rods cut to length. Link to that below. While this is a great option, I went ahead and picked up all my stuff at Ace Hardware, which turned out to be ever so slightly cheaper. Plus, I picked up a squaring tool and a few other things I'll need for later mods. Now we have everything we need to put it all together. Start by attaching the bottom front mounts. Simply take out the original screws, lift up the printer slightly, align the mount, use 3 M3 screws to fasten it in place. Don't tighten it down all the way just yet. Attach the back mounts in a similar manner. Next, the top mounts. First, make sure you're putting in the correct piece on the correct side, because each one is slightly different and you won't realize it until you try to insert the rods. Pro tip here, instead of removing all 4 screws from the corner at once, take only one out, attach the mount, and then remove and replace the other 3. This will save you from having to realign the gantry frame. With all the mounts in place, go ahead and tighten down the screws. Now, on each rod, slide a nut on both ends, going about a quarter of the way in, and then slide on 2 of the bolt fasteners. To install the rods, slide them up through the bottom of the top mount. With them in a vertical position, slide on another bolt fastener and a bolt. Doing this part now will save some headache later. Now carefully lift up the rod and let it settle into the bottom mount. Attach the locking nuts from underneath the bottom of the front mounts. I found it easier to slide the rod through the bottom mount about a half an inch, then screwed on the nut until it locked in place, and then slid the whole thing back into the mount. Now this is where the squaring tool comes in. You want to make sure the printer stays as square as possible as you tighten the bolt fasteners. Start by tightening down the bottom bolt fasteners until they are nice and snug. The fasteners of the top mounts are going to be used to fine-tune the brace. Adjust these until the printer is perfectly square on both sides. If the frame is leaning towards you, adjust the bottom fasteners up. If it's leaning away from you, adjust the top fasteners down. Double check everything is tightened down and square once again. Make adjustments as needed. Lastly, attach a rubber or felt pad to the bottom of each mount under the base. Any kind will do here, so it's up to you, but I wouldn't spend a whole lot of money on them. And that's it, we're done! You can clearly see how stable it is with the brace compared to it without. I really think this is one of the most important mods you can make to printers of this type, and I highly recommend you do it if you haven't already. There are a few things you can do to make it look better, like adding binder clips to the rods to classy them up a little bit, but I personally like the industrial look. I mean, it is a 3D printer, I'm more interested in how the models look compared to what made it. So what do we do now? Let's check our benchmark. This time I won't switch up the filaments in the middle of the print. The results. Of course, it's much cleaner than the last one, but that's more because it's come from one roll of filament. Like before, the arches and bridge on top have the same issue. I did notice, however, that the surface of the roof is a bit smoother than before, and the definition of the lip of the deck is ever so slightly sharper. I think it's beautiful. Again, I'm not an expert, so if you see something I didn't mention, please leave a comment. This has been an exciting project and I'm very happy with the results. Of course, there are quite a few more mods that will contribute to improving the print quality even more. I will continue to investigate more applicable ones and bring them to you soon. Special thanks to my subscribers that recommended the Benchy print and the Z-brace mod. You're awesome. Well, this has been Patrick CK. Like and share if you enjoyed this content. Subscribe to get more videos when they come out, and hope to see you all next time. Thanks, everyone.